Satisfy my love. everything to be grand. Oh, think of the Lord, the Lord's song.
Remember the cross. Jesus said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Take and eat, do this in remembrance of me." In the same way Jesus took the cup, he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant. Take and drink and do this in remembrance of me." We're to continue this delivery service. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, honor you, and we worship you today. Even though we didn't deserve it, you love us. And you brought salvation to us all. We thank you for that. Help us to honor you in our whole life and all that we do. We give you thanks. In Jesus' name we pray.
Good morning.
Good morning.
79 days. Does anybody know what 79 days from today is? Christmas Day. I was skimming the radio the other day and I heard Christmas music, so got to do the countdown. Just as a reminder, if you do not complete your communication cards, please fill them out and leave them on the pew and grab them at the end of the service. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Galatians, chapter 5, verses 13 through 25. You, my brothers, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge in the sinful nature. Rather, serve one another in love. The entire law is summed up in a single command. Love your neighbor as yourself. If you keep on biting and devouring each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. So I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in conflict with each other, so that you do not do what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under law. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, and debauchery, adultery, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us pray. Dear most heavenly Father, such a beautiful morning. Thank you for today. And thank you for an opportunity to share this scripture. And thank you for us to celebrate our appreciation to our pastors. We are truly blessed. We honor and praise you. In this we pray. Amen.
Aren't our elders doing a wonderful job? Yeah. We had a meeting yesterday morning, and I'm not going to tell you when this is going to happen. I will not tell you because I just know how people are. But there's a Sunday coming up where Pastor Chet and I both have to be gone. And it just worked out that way. It was just one of those, whoops, you got to do that. And I went to the elders and I said, okay, who's going to preach? One goes, I will. Well, I didn't have to twist any arms. I said, who's going to leave worship? One goes, I will. I go, yes. Boy, can you tell which one it is now? So I mean, it's really neat and exciting to see when the church steps up. And we don't have to go, okay, we got to get somebody from the outside. You know, we got people, quality men within the church that can lead the church without Chet and I. I think that's great. Okay, Kevin.
If anyone's interested in singing later this month, please come see me after the
service. Oh, I can't. But you can't get to lead worship now, do you? But I tell you, it's great. I mean, when you see this stuff happening, and it's just because the church, you're lining up to what the scriptures are saying, and that's exciting. How many of you enjoyed watching the kids take the instruments and start playing? When you see the little children worshiping, when you see these little children worshiping, because they don't have the hindrances of, boy, am I wearing the white clothes or whatnot, and they're just worshiping, you know something's happening, and you know something exciting is happening. So, okay, you know what? I'm going to go past this, because we've had this video enough, but I want to talk to you. We're going to continue on this series on the Holy Spirit. And the reason why we're focusing on the Holy Spirit is primarily because that's a part of the Godhead that's working in our lives and working in the church. Now here's the key. How do you know if someone is filled with the Spirit? How do you know if a church is filled with the Spirit? I want you to think about that. A lot of it has to do with you will know a tree by its fruit. Right? So, let's have a little exam here. You didn't know you were going to come to church and have an exam, did you? Okay, here we go. What tree does this come from? Somebody said a pear tree. Okay, someone is about ready to fail this course. Okay, what tree? What tree? What tree? What tree? What tree? Maybe. You know what? I put this in the first service, and what do you know? Mike Jerkowitz, our arborist, comes into science class. He says there is a tree called the hog hazelnut tree. So guess what? I'm still okay. This is the hog hazelnut tree. You will know the tree by its fruit. And a church or an individual Christian, you will know if how filled they are with the Spirit, how much the Spirit of God lives in them based upon the fruit that they display. I want you to really think about that. Based upon the fruit that they display. So if we display a fruit that's all about me, then who are they filled with? Me. If they display godly fruit, what are they filled with? The Spirit of God. Okay. I had Kevin read out of Galatians, the book of Galatians. Galatians is a book that the Apostle Paul wrote because there was a problem in the Galatian church. Legalism. What was happening was that you had these Jewish Christians, those who lived by the Jewish law, the Old Testament, and they were saying, in order to be a good Christian, you have to abide by the Old Testament law. Meaning, you have to, all the law there, you know, what to eat, what not to eat, the purification rituals, and all these things that you had to abide by in order to be a good Christian. Now the problem with that is that very easily can become legalism. And legalism is when we, basically is when, and legalism is when we have to versus the Spirit filled life is want to or love to. Okay, an example is this. When I stood up here 26 years ago, not in this church, but another church, and I was standing right here, I was wearing a white tux, and my father-in-law was standing right here, and I was waiting for those back doors to open. How many of you remember that? The back door is opening. The back door is opening, and here she comes, right down the aisle. And she came down in her white dress, and she stood right by me right here. At that point, we did the wedding vows. And the wedding vows are basically saying, I promise that I will love and cherish you, obey, and everything else till death does us part. A vow, or the marriage, when you marriage is actually a contract that you're saying, and I will not break that contract. At that point, when she said I do, and I said I do, I said to other women, you're done. You know what I mean? I'm saying at that point, I am pledging my life to you. That means I'm not going to go out on dates with other gals. Or am I going to be searching the internet on matchmaker.com or something like that, saying, boy, I wonder what else I can find out here. I'm saying I have pledged myself to you. Now, the United States government is not going to force me. Because the United States government has now produced this no-fault divorce and everything else. They're not going to force me to obey all of the contract, but I'm going to do it because I want to and I love to. And I protect myself in my marriage because she is of utmost importance. You hear what I'm saying? And the same thing in our own Christian walk, we should be doing the same thing. Apostle Paul says to the Galatian church, legalism is really should not be part of the church. We are free. We are free from the Old Testament law. And legalism, by the way, has crept into the church. Many times it is when we say, in order to be a Christian, you have to. Instead of, I want to and I love to. In order to be a good Christian, you have to. Remember in the 1930s and 40s and 50s, you know, men, in order to be a good Christian, you cannot have facial hair. Anybody remember that? Any of you remember where it says, men, in order to be a good Christian, you have to have an undershirt on. I remember that. There's also a group that says, men, you cannot have red on. I'm in trouble. I know a pastor who was fired from his job because he wore red socks. Might be ugly. But why? That's legalism that comes into play. Freedom says that all that I'm doing is because I love Christ and I'm going to do it to bring honor and glory to Christ. So let's say that I'm not going to have facial hair, which, you know, Ted's in big trouble, but I'm going to have facial hair, right? I'm not going to do it, but I'm not going to do it because I'm not going to put facial hair on because I want to honor God with my body. Now, I'm sure there's nowhere in the Bible that says anything about that. I'm just using that as an illustration. Galatians says, you, my brothers and sisters, are called to be free. Do not use your freedom to indulge in the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. So what Paul is saying is, you have freedom, but don't use it to dishonor God with your body and everything else. Don't indulge in the flesh. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping one commandment. Love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be devoured too. That's not on there, but you will be devoured too. And so Paul is saying, you know, you are free, but that doesn't mean that you can do whatever you want. It doesn't mean that because I'm free that I can sit there and I can watch what comes on television regardless. It doesn't mean that I can go into the bar and say, you know what? God made beer and it was great. Yeah. It doesn't mean that. It means that I'm free from it and I don't have to indulge in that anymore. Don't use that as an excuse. I was at the University of Huntington University about a year ago with David. David wanted to go into digital animation, and they have a digital animation department there. And they were some of the people who are in that department, some of the professors worked on VeggieTales. Some of them even worked on Transformers and doing the digital animation for it. And he made a comment, and it stuck with me, because we were talking about what Hollywood is doing and the junk that they put out and all this other stuff. And he made this comment. He says, you know, I want you to think about this. He said, many times we Christians say, don't watch R-rated movies, or watch R-rated movies as long as it doesn't have sex and nudity in it. That's the dividing line, right? And the reason why you don't watch it is because, you know, it's supposed to produce sin, it displays sin and produces pleasure, right? That's pretty much what they're saying. He says, then why are you watching those same movies when there's murder and mayhem going on? Because you're getting pleasure out of violence. Whoa, I never thought of that. Because we made that legalistic dividing line. It says, I'm not going to watch this because of that one issue. But yet we'll watch it and we'll laugh at and at you know, things blowing up and whatnot. Now, true, where's the divide line? Because everything is that way, it seems like. But I want you to think about that. We don't use our freedom to indulge in the flesh. Rather, serve one another. Everything that we do should be in a way that we are honoring God. Christians are free from legalism, but that's not a license to indulge in sin. It is a license to be filled with the Spirit. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 9 says, but whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their past sin. How many of us are nearsighted here? I am. I'm glad. I mean, you know what nearsighted is? For those who don't, nearsighted is you can't see far. You can see up close, but you can't see far. Now, my glasses are now off. You know what I see? I see colored blobs all over this congregation. Now, I know who you are because I know where you're sitting. But if you were to come in here today and you were to have different clothes on and you'd be sitting in a different spot, I couldn't recognize you right now. That's how nearsighted I am. Now, what Paul is saying is that those who indulge in the flesh are nearsighted. He's saying they just look at what's up close. They don't look at what's out there. It's all about me, is what he's saying. It's all about me. So when we indulge in that which we should not, you know we're watching a movie we should not, you know we're taking in our bodies things that we should not, it's nearsighted because it's to produce the instant pleasure without looking at the far-reaching results of that. We're seeing that in our society. Nearsightedness is just plaguing our society where people are doing what pleases them the most right now and not realizing how it affects the future. So if I go 120 mile an hour down I-75, it's bringing me pleasure right now, but what's going to happen eventually? And how does it affect someone else and someone else's family and whatnot? So that's what Paul says. But whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind. We were not remembering the fact that we are here to honor Jesus Christ and we are here to honor God. That's our main purpose. The Christian's desire quickly becomes that of the Holy Spirit. That's what we should do. Our desire should be that of God. Verse 18 of Galatians 5. But you are led by the Spirit. You are not under the law. So it's not the law that's telling us what to do. It should actually be the Holy Spirit that is guiding us. And we should be filled with the Spirit. Now, if you remember this little illustration that we've been using for the last couple weeks and months, is this is our life, remember? And then as we give our life to the Lord, the Holy Spirit comes into our life. And He fills our life with His presence. The problem is that we put ourselves in there and we push the Holy Spirit out of our lives. Remember that? The more we take out of ourselves, the more the Holy Spirit has control over our lives. Now, when I say control, I'm not talking about zombieism. You know, I'm a zombie. I have no control. You know, let me go. What I'm saying is that when He has more control of us, we are yielding to what He wants to do in our lives. And then He empowers us to do those things. The more a Christian immerses himself in the Lord, the more the Christian will take on the traits of the Lord, and the Christian starts to display the fruits of the Spirit. Now, I have this little experiment we're going to do. Okay? Let's say that this is my life, filled with the Spirit. Let's say this is me. And I'm going to put this in here. Put it down like this. Okay, there we go. I'm going to leave that in there for a week. We're immersing ourselves in the Holy Spirit. What do you think is going to happen in a week? The celery is what? The celery is going to start to turn red because it's bringing in the Holy Spirit, what represents the Holy Spirit. The more we immerse ourselves in God and we are yielding ourselves with the Lord, the more of the Holy Spirit, the more we start to display the traits of God. So what we're going to do is I'm going to leave this here this week. Now, a problem's going to happen. Anybody know what that problem is? Evaporation's going to happen. So throughout this week, what am I going to have to do? We're going to leave it here. This is my life. What we're going to have to do? The Bible says, do not get drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. That word filled means continually filled. with the Spirit. Meaning, daily, Lord, I am yielding to you. Daily, Lord, I'm immersing myself in you. Daily, Lord, I want you to be honored through my life. Daily, Lord, I'm yielding myself to you. Pastor, it sounds like you're saying every part of your life.
Yep.
But Pastor, you know, what about this part?
Yep.
That gets to the Lord as well. See, Christians, hear this. When you yield to the Lord, it's better. It's better. When I use Polly as an illustration, when you yield your life to the Lord, and you say, I'm going to live my life the way God wants me to in our marital relationship, it's better. When I yield my children and I raise them the way God wants me to raise them, it's children. But it's better. Because we've got the guidelines that God says this is how you're to raise your kids. It's better. But yet society says it's worse. Why does society say that? Because the society is not following the Lord. It's like watching Dr. Phil every day and saying, that's the guideline which I am to live. You know, I've taken psychology classes. My undergraduate is in counseling. You know what Dr. Phil says? He's saying basically what they want to hear many times. Not all the times, but many times. The Bible. Facebook's a good example. Okay, there on Facebook we have a military moms page that Polly is looking at, you know, trying to get advice and that type of stuff. And this one gal wrote on there, she goes, I'm so hurt. You know, I'm so hurt. I can't go see my fiance. I want to go see my fiance on family day. I got to stop that. On family day. Okay, I'm going to go see my fiance on family day. But yet my mother-in-law-to-be doesn't like me. She called me every name in the book. And yes, I've been married before. And yes, I have a two-year-old. And I looked at the picture of her. She looked like she was 16. And what happens? All these women. Do you know guys and gals look at things differently? How do you think the women went back at her? Oh, you poor little girl. Oh, just kill her with kindness. As a guy, you know how I wanted to respond? I'm not going to. Because guys, you know as well as I do. You respond. I wanted to say, honey, if that's how she's treating you now, you better understand that you're going to be marrying him, and you're marrying her too. See, we like the fluff. We'll keep going from church to church to church because we want to find the one that tickles our ears and makes us feel good. Or we go to people. When we're hurting, we'll go to people, I don't like that advice, but I finally found the advice I want instead of the truth, because we want the fluff. Just do it God's way. It's better. It's better. And yet, we want to hear the fluff. It's being filled with the Spirit, doing what God wants us to do. Now, that brings us to this point I want to bring up. There are four types of people in the world. Okay? There are those who are not saved. Our job is to go to those who are not saved and to share the good news of Jesus Christ. Regardless. The second one are those who are deceived. Those are individuals who think that they're Christian but are not. Those would be the ones that are Christian in name only. Those are the ones that says, you go down the street and say, are you saved? Yes, Lord, I'm a Christian. How are you Christian? Because I believe in God. Okay? I'm a Lincoln because I believe in Abraham. Right? Let's follow that same logic. I'm in Washington because I believe in George. Or maybe I'm a Conley because I believe in Chet. You see what I'm saying? That is a deception of the devil that has been brought out in the United States and in the world in probably the last 40 to 50 years. Believe in the existence of God and you are saved. Can you tell me where in scriptures it says that? But that makes us feel good because I believe in the existence of God and I can go out and do whatever I want. That's what I mean by deceit. Carnal Christian is the one that Paul talks about. The books of 1 and 2 Corinthians really focus on that. A carnal Christian is one who says that they're a Christian, but they're immature and they don't want to grow up. They're the babies. They're immature, self-centered, miserable Christians. How do you like that? Isn't that pretty blunt? Okay, how many of us know of babies? We got three babies in the church. How many of us know of babies? Come on, you better all raise your hand. Come on, raise your hand. There you go. Thank you very much. Okay. Aren't babies cute little things? I'm waiting to be a grandfather. No announcement. You turn into a babbling fool when you're even men turn into babbling fools. Okay, so you got this little baby right here, right? Right? I'm going to feed you filet mignon steak. No, we can't do that. Because they're immature. What do you feed them? The bottle. And they're yum, 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 yum. And then they smile and the milk comes out of their mouth. Yum, 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 yum. Okay. Then you feed them nothing but milk. Because that's all they can handle. What else do babies do? They cry. And why are they crying? Because they're not getting their way. You know, or good morning, mom, I'm hungry. Or, I need to do something with my diaper. Okay. Those are some other things. And most of the time, but they are also can be pull your hair out because of I want to sleep. What else do babies do? What? They go to bed, all right. You're right. What am I looking for? But you're right. What else do babies do?
They want their way.
They want their way. What else? Grow. Well, you guys are missing it. And I know you don't want to say it because we're in the sanctuary. They fill their diaper. And what I mean by that is they make a mess. Alright? Carnal, immature Christians. They don't want the meat. They want it their way. And if it's in a carnal, immature church, they make a mess. I have been in carnal churches. You're not a carnal church. Trust me. I've been in a carnal church. And you left there just gone. You felt dirty when you left. Because it was all about me. I want you to think about that. Am I carnal? Or am I the last one, spirit-filled? A spirit-filled will say it's all about thee. And all that I do is about thee. And all that I do when I'm at work or at home or all is to bring glory and honor to God. Some of the most intimate acts in a marriage, I'm going to tell you, are God-honoring because God ordained it. But it can also be destructive if it's taken out of God's guidelines. Raising your children are God-honoring, but it can also be destructive if you don't put God in the middle of the family. You know, your husband-wife relationship, being at work can be God-honoring. It really can, unless it's all about me and he does this or she does this and all this other. Christians, we should be the people that our employers are looking for to hire. They should be able to look at our resume and see the word Christian and they say, I want to hire them. All boils down to, is it about me or is it about thee? Am I mature or immature? Am I spirit-filled or am I not spirit-filled? Am I not saved? Fine. Not fine. If you're not saved, you need to give your life to the Lord. if you're deceived and you're saying, I just believe in God and that's all, well, I want you to study the scriptures and find out where that's at. And when you find out that's not there, you know, come to me and we'll talk to you. If you're carnal and it's all about you, I want you to say, Lord, stop making it about me. I want to make it about you and repent of it and say, I want to grow and I want to mature and I want the filet mignon. Yeah. When we were in Florida last week, Holly and I, or 2 weeks ago, we went to this restaurant and it was called Fogo Solotos or whatever it was. And it was a Brazilian meat restaurant. I mean, they got all the meats. Oh, it was wonderful. Oh, and it wasn't milk. Can you imagine just eating nothing but milk? It was meat. And men go, ha, ha, ha. Meat. It wasn't Panera. It was meat. Christians, get the meat. Hamburgers. Spirit filled. When you're spirit filled, you will display the fruits of the Spirit. You would have crucified the flesh, meaning all that I do is about you, Lord. Your direction becomes the Spirit's direction. And you live by the Spirit, and we keep in step with the Spirit. I got to get to it. Where's it at? I have the fruits of the Spirit up there. Where are they? Oh, well. They're up there somewhere. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, and faith. You will know them by the fruits that they display. We all fail in those times. Come on, I drive on 75. I know what it's like. Holly knows she hates it when I drive by 75 because I've become Darwin. No one gets in front of me on that 75. Don't you dare bump at me. Do I display the fruits? What does the sermon tell me about me? What am I going to do about it? I share this with you because we've been on this journey about the Holy Spirit. We're going to continue on because I truly believe that God wants every one of us to live by the meat. And I have been sensing and I have been noticing a transformation in this church, and it is a good one. And I'm noticing people's smile on their faces on Sunday mornings. And I'm noticing people with the energy on Sunday mornings. I'm noticing it, and it's good. And I'm noticing people saying, you know what? I need you to pray for my son or my brother or my sister or whatever. Because, you know, they need Jesus. And I'm noticing it, and that is good. We're watching it. We're seeing it. And it's all because we are yielding power of God and the Holy Spirit. And it's a wonderful ride. Because I like milk, but not all the time. But man, I can tell you, you can give me the filet mignon anytime. Right, guys?
Yes.
Okay, women. You can go to Panera and get your Danish anytime you want.
Yes.
Yeah. God wants us to grow. When we grow, what a ride. What a ride.
It's gonna be,
it is fun. It is fun.
Yes.
It's fun. Right? Let's pray. Father, I pray for these guys and gals and boys and girls, and I pray for them all that we will just continue to grow in you. It's exciting to see what's happening. May your blessing be upon each and every person. And may we continue to worship and give you thanks. Because you are God, and you are the God of this church. Not me, but you are. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
appreciation Sunday. And I want to hear appreciation right now from all you for the easy journey. Somebody's questioning you or wondering what you're doing. But I thank God that we have two who stand for God and aren't afraid to tell the truth and give it to us the way we need it. Feeds us a meal that we so desperately need so we can grow. It says in, I'm just going to read a couple of scriptures. Keep me safe, O God, for in you I take refuge. I said to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing. As for the saints who are in the land, they are the glorious ones in all my delight. In whom is all my delight? It's great when you have a pastor that delights in the growth of what God is doing, and they are a part of giving themselves to it. It also says, they go to Ephesians chapter 4. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. And I thank God that we have a pastor, an associate pastor, who strive for that for each and every one of us. And the love and concern that they have. And working with them, they truly, truly care about each one of you and your walk with Christ. And I thank God for that. We are fortunate to have men who serve the Lord and are full of the Spirit. Now I'm going to ask Kevin and Adam to anoint them for another year's service. And we are expecting great things as God works through these two. Amen?
Amen.
I think as we pray for them, we need to give them our support, our prayers daily, and our appreciation from time to time, because it's not an easy task that they take on. And no, they'll tell you, I don't want to hear how you appreciate them. They need to hear it now and then, so that they know the results. Tell them the good things God are doing, and that will encourage them more than anything of what God is doing in your life as they lead us. As we anoint them, let's pray, and I'm going to ask everyone to stand. And just put your hands out towards them. And you around the wives, put a hand on them, would you please? Where they can come up. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we just praise you for Pastor Darwin and Pastor Chet. And the heart that is open to receive from you, Lord. To receive what you have and then to give it back to us, Lord. To be instructed by you. To be willing to submit to what you desire, not put themselves first or their careers or their thoughts in the forefront, but to seek you and only seek after what you desire, knowing that that is what is best for this flock. Lord, as they lead us, just bless them and their families in all that they do, Lord, and draw them even closer to you, Lord, as we all do. Let them be the leaders, the examples that we need for each and every one of us. And Lord, we are so thankful that you have called them to their position and to this body. They are the fit. As you make all things perfect, Lord, you have perfect design in all you do. And we thank you for that. So bless them, their families, as they go forth this next year and fulfill the call that you have placed upon them. In Jesus' name.
Let
me just quickly say that when I came here 12 years ago, I had hair. And you're not the reason that I don't have hair now. I just grew too tall. I was a little short. But, you know, I see miracles every day. I never thought I would come to the place where I saw miracles every day. And I see miracles in each and every one of you. And I know that in name this is Pastor Appreciation Day, but I want you to know from the bottom of my heart that I couldn't do what I love to do if it wasn't for you. I thank you. Everything?
No.
Okay. All right. All right. This is why we're here. Let's go. Doc, do you have something here? Yeah.
Now glorified, now justified.